There are usually over 10 million children in the UK school system, but right now they're off and have been since the 23rd of March. We've asked several parents to film at home to see the impact of kids being off school and invited two experts, Super Nanny Jo Frost and educational neurologist Professor Paul Howard Jones, to also take a look.
I hate homeschooling because it is really boring and my mum always gets really stressed.
Right, come on, Barnaby, have a go by yourself.
At eight-year-old Barnaby's, it's time for homework, but he's struggling to remember where he left off.
Do you understand it? What don't you understand?
Nothing. I don't understand what I need to do.
A child's brain is still developing. So when Barnaby faces a problem like that, it can feel overwhelming. The important thing to realise is that the brain doesn't stand still. When we first learn something, it's vulnerable to loss, unless it is consolidated through rehearsal and practice.
On four-year-old Coco's lesson plan today, the alphabet.
Interactive learning programs online or television, as we saw there, little Coco having fun singing and dancing. Our children are very resilient. They adapt very easy if given the opportunity to have repetition, structure, love and affection and reassurance.
The Khalil family spans four age groups and school now takes place around the dining room table.
Do you know when I start school? Am I going to be in year one?
I'm not sure yet. I'm waiting for the Prime Minister to tell me.
You can actually set up a situation which is not unlike a school, and that makes it easier for children to know what the home learning rules are, but it also is helping to prepare them for returning to school later on.
The kids we spoke to are the lucky ones. They have supportive parents who are trying to do their best. But there's a hidden group of children in this country where that's not their reality. And for them, being off school could have the biggest impact. Figures from the educational charity the Sutton Trust show a third of pupils are taking part in online lessons while schools are closed. But that falls to just 16% of working class pupils. And when it comes to online learning, just 23% of schools in the most deprived areas had an online platform for pupils to receive work. And just 3% of teachers in state schools had hosted an online class, compared with 25% of private schools.
This pandemic is going to impact on children's education, not just in the short and medium term, but I sincerely believe it's going to have a long-term impact for many years to come. And I think that's very concerning.
In England, the row about schools going back on the 1st of June is intensifying. More councils are saying they won't be ready by the deadline, and the unions don't want members to go back either.
There seems to be this row between the government and yourselves. Are kids at risk of being lost in this?
Everything we are doing is for the children and the young people that we teach, and for our teachers and support staff and leaders. They are our prime concern.
Education's meant to be this great leveller. They're never going to be able to catch up, are they?
And we're very concerned about that, and that's why we've tried so hard. Teachers are phoning those children. They're trying to get them into school. They're providing them with work. But those vulnerable pupils will not be served by going back to a school where they could take COVID-19 back to their families and back to their communities. And that is what we're... Surely health has to come before anything else.
For the kids we spoke to, being off school for 9 weeks is unlikely to have a big impact on their future. But experts warn that won't be the same for all children.
Well, earlier I spoke to the Shadow Education Secretary, Rebecca Long-Bailey, and I asked her what she wants to see happen before schools are reopened.
There's a number of things that need to happen very, very urgently, in my view. And the first element is the government publishing its scientific advice, so that can be opened up for scrutiny. The second element is about test, track and trace and making sure that that's fully up and running before the government moves towards any wider reopening of schools. The third element is about creating a consensus with trade unions, the government and experts right across the sector to provide a detailed set of principles that need to be complied with by schools before they can reopen safely.
I mean, at the moment, you know, a lot of children have been totally let down because they're not getting online schooling, they're not getting online lessons, and they're basically being left to do nothing.
That's right, and there's a huge attainment gap question, and it's certainly been a topic for discussion throughout the lockdown. The government promised a few weeks ago, for example, to give laptops and digital equipment to disadvantaged year 10s as a start, and then maybe look at other disadvantaged children. And the rollout of that doesn't seem to be very effective so far. There's over 1 million children in homes who don't have access to a digital device. We also know that in some homes, children aren't receiving the support that they need. Even with the best parents in the world, that's no substitute for a teacher providing that one-on-one support.
But don't the teaching unions now need to tell their members that they need to get on with digital learning? They need to be doing lessons on Microsoft Teams or Zoom or whatever it is, when a lot of them aren't.
Many teachers are, but it doesn't address the fact that many students don't even have access to a digital device. There are homes where, you know, you've got five children trying to share their mum's mobile phone, for example, just to get access to online lessons. And that's where they're in a family where the parents can afford to have a mobile phone that has access to the internet.
But the problem remains that a lot of schools aren't providing lessons online for those children who do have digital devices and access to the internet. And the unions have been advising teachers in many cases not to do, you know, what the private schools have been getting on with.
The teachers are very mindful that every home isn't the same. Many children don't have access to digital devices, and many, even if they do, it would still be very difficult to replicate that online, you know, teacher face-to-face learning, if you like. So there needs to be an understanding that even if you did have online lessons provided to every single student in the UK, the conditions that they face at home aren't all the same. So it's not a panacea.
Would you say to the teachers' unions, particularly the biggest teaching union, which has told its members not to do online lessons, that they should be doing it?
It's fantastic if a school can provide online lessons, and I applaud the work of teachers that have done that. But there's nothing that can constitute face-to-face support with a teacher. And there's a huge amount of work that's going to be required when we go back to school, whenever that date may be, when it's safe to do so, to help those pupils catch up.
Rebecca Long-Bailey, thank you very much.
Thank you.